Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Assalamu alaikum, dear students. I'm Saima Afzal, and today we have to deal with the third topic of your history chapter, that is Jalaluddin Muhammad Akbar, who became the ruler of subcontinent after the death of his father Humayun in 1556. It is on page number 79 of your textbook. As I have already mentioned, that Akbar became the ruler of subcontinent after the death of his father Humayun. He was the third Mughal emperor who ruled between 1556 till 1605. He ruled for almost 49 years. He was born in 1542 at Umarkot during Humayun's exile. Although he did not get any formal education himself, but he was very fond of learning and loved to invite learned and skilled people to his court and get new ideas. He was a very powerful ruler and conquered many areas and expanded the empire. For this reason, he is considered to be the real founder of the Mughal Empire. Now you are going to ask why Ma'am Saima is saying that he was the real founder of Mughal Empire, since it was founded by Zahiruddin Babur in 1526, and Babur was the founder of Mughal Empire, and now we are talking about year 1556. The reason is that Babur spent only 4 years in the subcontinent. He stayed here only for a very short period of time, between 1526 till 1530. In these 4 years, he fought 4 major battles to establish his rule in the subcontinent. After his death, Humayun, who became the next emperor, he was not as strong as his father, so he had to face many problems during his period. He even lost the areas that were conquered by his father, and the last blow was when he was defeated by Sher Shah Suri and he had to leave India. So it was during Akbar's period that the Mughals not only reconquered their lost areas, but conquered other parts of India as well. And therefore, Mughal Empire was expanded during his rule, and it became a big kingdom. The areas that were conquered during his rule, they are mentioned at page number 80 of your textbook. He conquered Gwalior, Ajmer, Jaunpur, Malwa. He also conquered the famous fort of Ranthambore and Chittore. He sent military campaigns to Gujarat, Bihar, Odisha as well. He conquered Kandahar, Kashmir, Sindh and Balochistan. He tried to conquer the Deccan Plateau, but he was only able to conquer Barir and Ahmednagar. If you are going to have a look at page at the map given on page number 80 of your textbook, the mustard portion shows the areas that were under the control of Akbar at that time. It shows the extent of Mughal Empire during Akbar's period. So Mughal Empire expanded a lot during this period. So after this, we have to move to Akbar's policy towards Rajputs. Rajputs were very strong and powerful people of northern India. Akbar knew that if he want to strong control over India, then he is in need of Rajput support. So Akbar developed friendly relationships with them. They were appointed ministers in Akbar's cabinet. Akbar allowed the Mughals to marry in Rajput family. He himself married Maryam Zamani, who belonged to a Rajput family, so he assured that Rajputs would never create problem for him, and he is going to have a smooth administration. Moving on to page number 81 of your textbook, Establishment of Good Governance. Akbar, he was a military genius and conquered many areas, but he was a very good ruler and administrator as well. He divided his empire into 15 provinces, and governors were appointed there. Each governor was responsible for his province, and he was answerable to the emperor. Moving on to financial reforms on page number 81, reform means a big change. Financial reforms means steps taken by Akbar to collect money that was later used to run the empire. So the reforms that were introduced by Akbar included the system of taxation or tax collection. Here, very important thing is that rich were taxed more as compared to the poor. That is means rich were supposed to pay more tax, more money or tax as compared to the poor people. Agriculture area was increased, and more crops were produced in order to get better crop crop production. Indian peasants or farmers, they were required to pay 1/3 of their annual crop production to the state or the king. It means if someone is producing 90 kg of crop, then he has to give 30 kg to the government. So 1/3 portion of the crop was given to the government. However, if due to some reason, if the crop production suffered or failed, taxes were reduced or sometimes suspended, means the farmers were not supposed to give tax of that particular year. Trade and manufacturing of goods, that is buying and selling of good to other country, was promoted and it increased during this period. The things that were produced or made in India, like cloths, food products, spices, gemstones, were sent to other countries in return of gold and silver. Moving on to Mansabdari system. Mansabdari system was a system that was introduced by Akbar in 1570. He appointed mansabdars who were answerable to him. Their job was to collect land and other taxes. Another very important task for them was to provide an army or soldiers to the emperor at the time of war. So what they used to do was that they made lists of the people under them, and those people had to serve as an army against the Akbar's opponents during the time of war. So mansabdar had two tasks. One is to collect taxes and the other is to provide soldiers to the emperor during war. Moving on to Akbar's religious reforms, Akbar was a very tolerant ruler. In order to consolidate or strengthen his rule in the subcontinent, he kept friendly relationships with all communities of India, people of different religion and faiths. They were invited to Akbar's court. He appointed non-Muslim ministers in order to rule peacefully. Akbar incorporated or amalgamated or put together principles of different religion and found a new religion, which is known as Deen-e Ilahi. Now, which is mentioned on page number 82 of your textbook. Muslim religious scholars were not happy at all with Akbar's new religion. We have a reference of one such religious scholar, Mujaddad al-Afsani, at the end of your topic. So this new religion, it was not appreciated, liked or followed by the Muslims, and it came to an end once with the death of Jalaluddin Akbar. He passed away in 1605, and he was succeeded followed by his son Salim, who assumed the title of Jahangir when he became the next ruler. So this was your topic. I hope now it is going to be easy to understand once you are going to go through it. I want you to go through your lesson before your next interactive session, so you would be able to discuss your problems with your teacher. Plus, you must be ready with your neat notebooks during your interactive session, because we have to do questions related to this topic during this session. Thank you so very much, dears. Allah Hafiz.